In this video, we're gonna start to work on our base color, and we're gonna focus on the ground first. So just as we did in the previous video, we used our height information to create our roughness map. We're going to use our height map, which you see here in the 2D view, we're going to use that to start to generate our base color. So here, if I hit my space bar, I can create a gradient map. And this gradient map is going to allow me to colorize any grayscale information. So for example, if we take our height and I add it here into the input of this gradient map, you can see that we have this gradient that appears here. So we have black on the left and it goes all the way to white here on the right. And if I click the gradient editor button, I have an editor that I can work with. So here we have this ramp. The values on the left, these black values, represent all the dark values that are coming from the input that we have fed into this gradient map. And here on the right of the ramp, this represents all of the white values that are coming in to the gradient map. So what I can do is I can just left click here, and you can see that it starts to create these keys for me. And if I left click on a key, it highlights blue, and this lets me edit this. So let's come over here to this key, which is going to represent remapped values for this dark range. And I'm just going to choose like a red value. Then I'm going to come over here to the white key, select it, and choose just a blue value. And so now this ramp just lets us remap these grayscale values coming in to the colors we set on these individual keys. And since this is a gradient, you can see we have a nice transition, in our case, going from red to blue. So this gradient map is going to provide us with a method for colorizing some grayscale data, which again is coming from our original height map that we created. However, before we do this, I want to do some more work here to this height map. I don't want to just feed this straight into that gradient. And the reason is because the more intricate or more detail you have in this height map, the more color variation you can get using the gradient map. So what I'm going to do first is I'm going to hit my space bar, and I'm going to do a search here for curve. And you'll see that we have a couple of these curvature nodes. And the one I want to use here is this curvature smooth. So I'm going to left click to create this node. The input of this node takes a normal map. And lucky for us, we already have our normal map. So let me take the output of my normal and just plug this into the curvature smooth. And this is the result that I get. So this gives us all this curvature information from our height map. And you can see we now have a lot of really good detail that we can work with. All right, so I have this. The next thing I'm gonna do is just use a blend here. And I'm gonna take the curvature smooth in the foreground. And then I'm gonna take the height. This is my original height before it gets fed into my extracted maps. I'm gonna feed this here into the background. And so what I'm gonna do here is just simply adjust my opacacity to around 0.5 or so. So I'm just gonna do basically a 50% blend from the foreground and the background here. So this is the result that I'm getting. Now I'm going to use another blend here, and we'll feed the result of this blend into the background. And here in my noises in my library, I'm going to use this grunge map 13. Of course, you could use any map that you want, but the idea here is that I just want to build up some more information here. Okay, so I'm going to take the result of this grunge map here into the foreground, and in my case, I'm going to choose the soft light blending mode, and then I'm just going to kind of feather that back here just with my opacacity setting. So maybe I'll try, let's just do a value of 0.7. So now I'm getting this result. So once again, I'm going to create another blend. So you can see I'm just continuing to build up more detail here. This time, I'm just going to drop back to our roughness. And we already have this grunge map 15. I think this will provide some nice little detail. So we already have it. It's always good to reuse nodes in your graph for optimizational purposes. So I'm going to take the result of this grunge map here, and I'm going to plug that into the foreground of my blend. Now for this guy, I'm also going to just use a soft light blending mode, and again, just play around with the opacity here. So we'll get something like this. All right, so at this stage, we have a lot of detail. We've blended a curvature smooth result, a grunge map, two different grunge maps, and we're blending this all with our original height map. However, when I look at this result, it's a bit too contrasted. There's a pretty wide range here, going from kind of like these dark splotchy areas all the way up to kind of these more white areas here. And I think this is going to be a bit too extreme. And what I want to do is just balance out these tones. So in order to do that, I'm going to use a high pass grayscale node. So once again, I'll hit my space bar, we'll do a search for high, and you can see that we have this high pass grayscale. So I'm going to use this node, and I'm gonna plug in my blend here. And so you can see that just using the high pass, we're able to, you know, flatten out or better balance a lot of these extreme ranges that we have. And then I can also play around with the radius for this. So I think I might do something more like that. So here's the result we had before, and here's the result after we've more balanced this with our high pass grayscale. Okay, so now that I have this final grayscale image, I can now feed this into my gradient map. So we'll feed this here into our gradient map. And so this is the result I'm getting for my color. However, this red to blue gradient is really not going to give me the result that I want. So now I just need to come in here to my gradient editor, and I need to start to just pick or plot a few keys here. And of course, if I just left click, I can create as many keys as I want and change the value. And you can see the result here of just going through and just, you know, changing different keys. I can left click, I can drag these guys around. And again, these keys are colorizing this grayscale information that's coming into the gradient map. However, there's an even better way to work with this gradient editor, and that is to use this pick gradient option. What this allows me to do is sample a range of colors, and the gradient editor will automatically plot keys here in the color ramp. So this is a really good tool to use when you have some reference art. Now, to demonstrate this, I'm going to use a tool called Quattro, which allows me to view, manage, and work with reference art. It's a free tool that I use, and it was created by Luis Cruel. So here you can see I'm just going to drag in a piece of reference art, and this Quattro tool is just letting me float this image over top of Designer. So what I'm going to do now is just activate the pick gradient. You can see that I have a little color pick tool, and I can just mouse over this reference image and I can sample different colors. Now, to sample a range of colors, all I have to do is just left click and drag. So let's say I want to work with this area here. I'm just going to left click and drag, and you can see I have this black line. This indicates the range that I am selecting, and when I let go of my mouse button, the gradient editor automatically plots a bunch of keys based on the pixel values that are represented by that black line. Since the line was fairly long, you can see it sampled quite a lot of keys here. So what I'm going to do is use my pick gradient once more, and I'm just going to left click and make a smaller line, let go of my mouse, and now I pick another range of values here. All right, so let me just move my reference art out of the way, and I'm going to close my gradient editor. And so I'm viewing the map that was created. I need to view that in my 3D view. So let's just back out here and come back over to our base material. And under the user-defined maps, I'm just going to enable the base color channel, and I'm going to take the result of this gradient and just plug that directly into that base color input. And so here is the result that I'm getting based on a sampled range of values from my reference art. So now I can go back here to the gradient editor, and I can work with these keys even more. So for example, if I left click on a key and drag it straight up, I can delete it. Like I said, I can move these around. I can make changes to them. Another thing I can do is select a range of keys. So here I'm going to left click and just drag out a selection box. You can see I've selected all of these keys here, and I can edit them all at the same time. So I might come over here to my value and just drop that value range a little bit. So now you can see the result that I'm getting here, where the darker range of my gradient map, I've set those keys and I've just lowered their value as well. So using the pick gradient is a very great tool. Like I said, you can just sample directly from your reference art to get the exact color values you want, and then you can come in and edit the keys here, change them, do whatever you want to do to get the end result that you want. So this is looking pretty good for me for now, so I'm going to leave it like this. So here we have this base color value. I'd also like to go back here to this curvature smooth node that I have, and I'd like to blend this back over top of this albedo value that I have so far. So what I'm going to do, since this is actually outputting a grayscale map, I'm going to convert that to color by just simply using another gradient. So here I'll take the result here of the curvature smooth, and I'm going to plug that into a gradient map like this. I don't like how this line, this connection line, is running right through these nodes. It's kind of hard to visually see the flow of my graph, so I'm going to hold down Shift and Alt. I'm going to left click on this little yellow dot to just drag out this connection line, and then you can see I've just kind of rerouted the way this looks. So now I can visually see what's happening here and how this curvature smooth node is driving these two branches here of my node tree. So now let's take the result of the curvature and my gradient map and blend them together. So we'll just plug this curvature smooth in the foreground, this gradient map here in the background, and then I'm going to just set this here to maybe a soft light. Actually, let's just do an overlay here. Okay, so now that I have that overlay, I'm going to take the result of this blend and place this here into my base color. And so now I'm getting some kind of edge highlights here. It's a little intense by default. So I could come over to this blend and I could drop its opacity back. So that's one thing I could do. Another thing, since this is a gradient map, we could go to the gradient editor. And here again, I could just plot a key here for the white value. And maybe I could just lower its value to get just a different result as well. So I'll do something like this. Close the gradient editor and go back to my blend. And then here, drop the opacity value here as well. All right, so now I'm just gonna add just a little bit more variation to this color. The next thing I'm gonna do is hit my space bar and I'm gonna do a search here for dirt. And we have this dirt 3 node. I'm gonna use this one here. Then I'm going to create a gradient map for this. So we're gonna be converting this dirt here, this grayscale value to a color. And then we're gonna blend this with our base color we have been working on. So we'll plug this into here. Now I'm gonna come into the blending mode and I'm gonna set this to subtract. And so it's pretty intense by default, but here what we'll do is we're just gonna feather this back and drop our opacity down. So what we're doing here in our base color, you can see that we're just breaking things up a bit further. And so I chose that dirt 3 noise because it provides me with this speckled noise effect. All right, so let's take the result of this blend and pipe that into our base material. And now here is the result that we're getting. And again, I might wanna just feather that back a little bit here with the opacity. So one last thing I wanna talk about before we close out this video is the idea or the concept of making sure that the albedo map that we're creating is going to be PBR safe. So if you come over to the library and you check out the material filters, there's a section here called PBR utilities. And within this category, there's a node called the PBR base color metallic validate. Let's left click and drag and drop this node here into the graph. And then what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take the result of our blend. Now this is the node that we're piping straight here into the base material. So this is our base color or albedo. And I'm going to plug this right here into the base color input of the PBR validate node. So we'll double click this node and you can see that what it shows me here in the 2D view is a full green. And this means here that the colors that I'm working with, these are all PBR safe, or the value ranges are fitting within PBR safe guidelines. So if I take a look at the node, you can see here the validation mode is set to albedo. That's what we want to check. And then we have this albedo dark range threshold. And we have an option here for 30 or 50. So I'm going to keep this here at 30. So basically what this means is the PBR validate would show in red any values that are falling below or are darker than this 30 sRGB value. So to illustrate that here, I'm going to just select this connection line and just place the levels into here. For this levels here, let's take our input black and let's just move this up and make some really dark values here. Now, if we take a look at our PBR validate, you can see that it's showing us a lot of these red areas, which indicate we have values that are falling below 30 RGB. We could also choose to overlay our map. So if I enable this to true, it just gives me a more clearer view of where these out of range colors are falling within my original base color map. So you can use the PBR validate node to make sure that as you're working, you're creating PBR safe content. So for example, here, I'm just gonna go back to my levels. Here I can see that I have these red values. And then if I just start to make some adjustments here, I can see the red going away. So now I know for the most part, my color ranges here in this map are now PBR safe. All right, so that's gonna close out this video. In the next video, we're going to start to colorize the pebbles.